The Senate of the USA, in fact, is a unique example of the Second Chamber, and it has an event character where it enjoys appointment of the federal officers, not only that, even the approval of the treaties. And nowhere in the world, the Second Chamber, anywhere in the world, enjoys such a power, and that is the strongest feature of the upper house. Even in Swiss and Netherlands, in Swiss we have a bicameral legislature wherein both the council, I mean the assembly as well as the council has the same power and the authority. In Netherlands it is a very unique example when any piece of legislature can be rejected. And see, in India there were a lot of evolution. Especially the constitutional pundits made a lot of deliberation set up this legislative, upper house of the legislative council. Even they studied the different world constitutions, and that is how the Rajya Sabha was evolved. Rajya Sabha was created, and it is being even known as the Council of State in the federal setup. But much before that, in the Constituent Assembly, the greater emphasis was given by Babasaheb Ambedkar regarding that there is a need for the Legislative Council to suit the Indian genesis. A lot of deliberation was also there from certain committees, and that is how the Legislative Council came, Upper House came into an existence. But much before that, in the transverse of time, when we go, as we transverse through the earlier times, the Mysore, which happens to be a model and a powerful state under the Maharaja of Nalvadi Krishnaraja Wadayar and then the Diwanship of V.P. Madhav Rao, they emphasized that the further constitutional reforms took place in order to set up the Legislative Council on March 6, 1907. A separate promulgation was done and this was established. But much before to that, the first bold constitutional reform was taken in the Mysore during the time of Jayachamarajendra X, wherein the representative assembly was constituted in 1881, in 7th October, it was inaugurated. This is a amazing progress in the entire country, and it is unique appointing effort, particularly in Karnataka. And especially this has been appreciated by the democrats, whereas there was a war from the Britishers. But it may be recalled that Lord Dufferin came over to Mysore and appreciated Jayachamarajendra Wadayar for having introduced these democratic institutions, particularly I am talking about the representative assembly. Even the Viceroy, Lord Ripon, who himself was a Democrat, and he was a man who laid a strong foundation that the government should be associated with the people. Keeping in all this, the Mysore royalty were very much open to the progressive ideas, and very progressive ideas. And about the statecraft, which attracted the appreciation of Democrats. And this is how, I'm talking about the upper house, that is regarding the Karnataka Legislative Council, which happens to be the oldest legislature in the country. And first, namaste to one and all. My humble salutations to the Honorable Speaker, Sri Vishweshwara Hegde Kagari. And this has been done under the rediscovery of Vidhana Sauda. And this has been initiated by Srimati Vasanta Kavita. Then the inputs for the entire Karnataka Legislative Council by Srimati Kavita. Yes, editor Rajadharma Mysore. Then before I go into the detail aspect, the timeline series of this evolution of the Karnataka Legislative Council, I would like to draw the primary objective. What was the primary objective? When we go, the primary objective was that in making up the lawmaking process, the associating of a number of non-officials, particularly who have knowledge and who have practical experience of the local condition, that was the main thing. But it was that was a main theme or a main prime objective of the setting up of the Legislative Council. But there were certain prime objectives. But let me go. What are the prime objectives of this? The first is to enable the people to place their wishes or their wants by the government through the members who are qualified for it. That is first thing. And the second thing is that to give a legislative measures a benefit of personal discretion by a larger competitive persons rather than the members of the by the executive council. And the next one, to ensure, to facilitate, ensure and consider every detailed measure with the references of the standing committee. And finally, in order to understand the advisory service from the legal luminaries, bar service in the process of lawmaking. But one important aspect is to provide the degree of publicity which is necessary to ensure the free independent discussion of Karnataka legislative measure from the all points of view. And the composition of the council, it consists of the president, two vice presidents, and the non-official members. The strength of the non-official members was 1/10 were nominated. The term of the members were 2 years, and 2/5 were the non-officials. And the strength of the during that time was not less than 50. Then the only limitation that during that time the council had was the appointment of the non-officials was rest with the government. And even though, one of the larger composition of the non-official members were there, maybe Shankar Rao, Shama Rao, Krishna Rao, Narsinga Rao, then Venkata Krishnaya, then Narsingaya, Nanjundaya, Sitaramaya, Ramaswamy Chetty, MC Rangayangar, B.V. Ramaya Chetty, K.P. Putana Chetty, Ananta Chetty, B.K. Garudachar, only the lone members of Muslim Ghulam Ahmad and Kalmi Hoskoppa, C.R. Reddy, and finally H.D. Basappa. And there were the legal luminaries. They were not only the legal luminaries, they were a high standard of debates, they had a debating skills, they made a beautiful presentation, they were all patriots concerning to the public interest. The public interest was taken a major in their presentations. And next one, apart from this, now for a better understanding to the evolution based on the experience regarding the Karnataka Legislative Council, which happens to be the oldest in the country, the timeline follows. One, the first important thing is that in 1893 itself, the members of the Representative Assembly urged association of number of non-officials in the lawmaking process. And again in 1903, again there was a movement among the Representative Assembly. They pressed for the establishment of what we call Legislative Council in the administration of Mysore province, and said that the public interest is better served by associating certain number of non-officials in the process of lawmaking. That is, again, I underline this emphatic point. And the next one is the members like Ramanujam Iyengar from Gubbi, Srinivas Rao from Chikmagalur, and D.S. Venkata Ramaya from Bengaluru, then again Venkata Krishnaya. And there were the frontline leaders who insisted strongly for demanding the Legislative Council. Then finally, the government assured that the careful consideration will be given. And later in the meantime, M.C. Rangayangar made a detailed memorandum. He presented a detailed memorandum along with others to the Diwan P. Madhav Rao, that is later submitted to the Maharaja. Then Maharaja also felt that the prime objective was very much relevant, and therefore he promulgated an order on 6th March 1907 for the constitution of regular council for making laws and regulations. Then again, 24th July, the first meeting was held at the public office in Mysore in 1907 with a view to respect the wishes of the Representative Assembly. Maharaja Nalvadi Krishnaraja Odia established the Legislative Council with a full-fledged Legislative Council. In 1908, the rules were framed formed by the government for the Legislative Council regulations. And next, in 1911, the candidates who got the majority votes were being nominated to the Legislative Council. In 1914, interpolation was allowed and the supplementary questions were allowed for the members. In 1950, this house was empowered to discuss the budget matters. And not only that, it was the first time it became quite active. The next one is, in 1917, the term of the council was 3 years. In 1919, the members were allowed to move the resolutions. And the strength of the council increased to 30 members. The 12 officials were there, plus 18 non-officials. Or among 18 non-officials, 8 were officials elected. Then again, in 1923, Bajendranath, who happens to be the vice chancellor of the Mysore University, a seal committee was formed. And this was the first constitutional, a bold constitutional reforms initiated by then Maharaja Nalvadi Krishnaraja Wadiyar, wherein the house was permitted for the vote of crowns. The next one, cut motion was there. When you take the cut motion, which is even non-votable, that was made votable. That was the one unique feature of the house. And the next one is, in 1927, the disqualification of gender was removed and the women were given an opportunity to contest election both in the legislative council as well as in representative assembly. In 1935, based on the recommendation of the Steel Committee, the standing committee was constituted. It composed of 6 members, 4 from the assembly and 2 from the council. And next one, in 1938, K.R. Srinivas Iyengar committee was appointed further to study and examine the functions of the legislative institutions and also to formulate the comprehensive policy or a proposal for the further changes as desirable. That means, in order to secure the steady, harmonious constitutional progress of the state. And again, in 31st August 1939, K.R. Srinivas Iyengar submitted the report and the council strength was increased to 68 and the continuance of the institutions was there. In 1940, the recommendation of K.R. Srinivas Iyengar was incorporated in Mysore Act and the term was increased to 4 years. And again, in 9th July 1941, the first and the joint session was there by the government. There was a lot of agitation between the government and the legislature to have a representative assembly. In 1947, October 29th, the ministry was expanded and the ministry was responsible to the legislature and the constituent assembly of Mysore was done in order to make a constitution of the Mysore state. But then what happened that the elected members from the assembly was drawn for the constitution to pass the constitution bill, and later on the Chamarajendra Wadiyar accepted, promulgated that the constitution being framed with the constituent assembly of the India shall be the constitution of the Mysore state. And finally, the house was dissolved on November 5th, 1949, and the Constituent Assembly of Mysore converted itself as the Provisional Assembly till 1952. And finally, in 1973, the Legislative Council became a permanent body, and the members retired once, one-third members retired in 2 years, and the strength of the council was increased from 62 to 75. 25 members got elected from the Legislative Assembly, 25 from the local areas, local bodies. Then again, 7 from graduates, 7 from teachers' constituency, and last 11 nominated by the government. And with this conclusion, that is, the Karnataka legislature is functioning very well, and now the present chairman, Shri Basavaraj Horatti, has been a chairman of the Karnataka Legislative Council, and he has taken a lot of reforms. And this is Gnanshekar. Namaste.